Support for military personnel through legislation, that is the focus of Your Voice today. I'm your host, Julia Locandy. Hi, senators. How are you?
Morning. Well.
So today we are joined by two senators, both veterans, now friends, right?
Absolutely.
Senator Rob Ortt and Senator Tom Croci, thank you for being with us today.
Thanks for having us.
So starting with Senator Croci, why don't you just give us a little bit of background about your military career?
Something I always wanted to do, as most people who join the military, that it's something, it's a vocation, something they're called to do. From a young age, I wanted to join. I tried many different ways. Finally, after going to graduate school, I got the opportunity to get a direct commission through Officer Candidate School. Served as a squadron intelligence officer with S-3s on an aircraft carrier, and then had the ability to join a different community and be a part of Naval Special Warfare, supporting them with Afghan operations mostly. And also had the ability to be at the White House for a couple of years in the Situation Room, working for President Bush. So I had a great opportunity, kid from Long Island, got a lot of breaks thanks to the Navy.
And Senator Ortt?
Well, like Senator Croci said, you know, it was something that you do think of long before you often do it. I had thought about it coming out of high school, actually, and of course my parents were very big on me going to college and, you know, not going into the military. My mom was nervous or scared or whatever, like a lot of parents. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, it was something I thought about in college. And then September 11th for me was really the push to join. And so I enlisted October 26th, actually, 2001. So just a few weeks after. And so that was, for me, that was, I knew it was the right thing to do, I think, given those events.
So, Senator Croci, you chair the Committee on Veterans, Homeland Security, and Military Affairs. Give us some key issues that you are working on in the budget and then throughout the legislative season.
Well, I think we look at it, and Rob and I have talked about this a lot, when you're in the military, regardless of the service, your social network, your support network, that structure all exists around the military base. And when you come to New York, you come back as a veteran, return home to New York, we don't have as many bases as other states do. We don't have the same infrastructure. We have Fort Drum upstate, which is our largest and still active operating base. But if you're on Long Island, for instance, or other parts of the state where you don't have that network, you rely on the state for that network. You rely on the federal government, the VA, for that network. So I think our jobs are to make sure that there is a network there, that lets veterans know when they come back to New York, hey, this is your home state, there are resources here. You're not going to find them necessarily at a military base because you may not have one near you, but let's look at other things we can do. So my focus this year, working with Senator Ortt, is to make sure that there are those resources there and they're growing, that those resources grow as our veteran population grows. So whether it's treatment for PTSD, whether it's tax exemptions for veterans who have served in combat, whatever the issue might be, it's so that there's a support network there and veterans feel like, I can come to New York, I can get a job, and I can have the support that I need.
Now, there is a really great opportunity for both of you to work together. Senator Ortt, you are the chairman of mental health issues. So how do you see those worlds overlapping between people with mental health issues and veterans?
Sure. Well, I think there's a lot of overlap. And as Senator Croci was saying, you know, we've been working together because there's really two main focus points, I think, for veterans. One is on the mental health side, the service side. The other aspect is the job side, the economic side. Certainly on the mental health side, when you talk about returning veterans dealing with PTSD, TBI, going through mental, you know, emotional stress issues, you know, there's the Dwyer program, which I know Senator Croci you probably will talk about, which has been peer-to-peer counseling with veterans, has been very successful all across the state. We want to see that expand. And there's a number of other programs and research that's going on dealing with mental health and dealing with TBI and PTSD. And I think we need to make sure that we have services here and that New York State is doing all we can, both providing resources and providing services to these folks who are coming back who are dealing with these issues. Because in many cases, there's a stigma.
Yeah.
There's a stigma with mental health, which we've talked about before on the show in general, certainly amongst military amongst veterans. You know, there's a bit maybe machismo or you don't want to admit you're broken or there's something wrong with you. And the truth is, I don't look at that there's anything wrong with someone who's dealing with mental health issues. I look at it almost, and this might, and I don't mean to downplay it, but, you know, I wear glasses. okay? Now, without my glasses, I could be a danger if I'm driving around because I can't see anything, in truth. Mm-hmm. I put my glasses on or my contacts, I'm fine. And so I want folks that are dealing with mental health issues a lot of times to understand that they can get treatment, they can be, you know, they can be productive members of society as long as they're, you know, taking their medications or they're going to their counselings or whatever it might be. There's nothing wrong with them. There's nothing wrong with admitting that you are dealing with mental health issues and getting help.
Right.
And so as veterans, we have friends that serve with us that are dealing with these issues, and I think it puts us in a unique position to advocate for these folks and be a strong voice for these folks.
Right. It affects veterans. It also affects their families and the communities.
Absolutely.
Can you tell us a little bit about the Joseph P. Dwyer program for peer support?
Sure. It started from my predecessor in the Senate, Senator Lee Zeldin, who had a friend who killed himself, a veteran, who committed suicide, and it's all too common for us to hear about or to have to go to funerals of young men and women, more predominantly men, who take their own lives because it's a muscle memory thing. That's what we like to say in the military. When you're trained to shoot or you're trained to do a skill, you develop a muscle memory. You repeat that action so many times that when the pressure is on, you're able to do it without thinking. You're able to do the right thing without thinking. They don't train us to come home that way. They don't give us muscle memory to come home and deal with the pressures and the emotions that you feel when you return home from deployment. We're getting better at it in the military. The Dwyer program is designed to be a network of individuals who are going through the same things, who can talk in anonymity about what's going on. And you instantly realize when you're in that situation that you're not alone, that the emotions you're feeling are not unique to you, that the problems you're having in your life with your family are not unique to you. And like the 12-step programs that were developed in the 1930s, AA and others, it's completely anonymous. You're just on a first-name basis. Anything that happens in that circle never leaves that circle. And it's helping a lot of veterans. It's not only helping them deal with the stresses of returning home or helping with the PTSD if they have it, but it also opens them up to a network of brothers and sisters that they didn't know they had. They were living right down the street, and resources and job opportunities. So it's really having an effect. It's in 12 counties throughout the state, and I hope it grows this year.
Yeah, so no matter the issue, it really does make a lot of sense to talk to someone who knows where you're coming from.
Amen.
So what's next for the Joseph P. Dwyer program?
Well, working with Rob, we're trying to expand it. We certainly want it to be a fixture in our budget. We want that program to be solidified, grow it to other counties throughout the state, hopefully eventually expand the amount of funding that we're able to provide to the program as we grow and as New York's economic picture begins to look brighter and brighter every year. Veterans should be a part of that economic picture. Certainly, if we have the ability to make sure we can get people back into the workplace who are suffering from PTSD and get back into life, well, that's as leaders, that's our job.
Right. So you both have been really outspoken about the need to make sure veterans have a job when they come back home. So what is the state's role in this, do you think? Either one.
Well, I think, you know, from a job perspective, a lot of it is doing what we're doing across the state for anybody looking for a job. Yeah. We want to create a healthy economy where good paying jobs are prevalent, where someone who wants a job can find a job. A lot of folks who return from combat or just from serving the military, there's a certain skill set that they have. They've learned to be part of a team. They know about the importance of showing up on time. They know about, you know, they have a lot of leadership capabilities. Even if you're not an officer or a senior commander, you're taught leadership all throughout the military. So there's a lot of skills that I think military veterans bring to the table that are positives for employers. We've done certain things like create incentives for employers that hire veterans, whether it's tax credits or other economic incentives. So I think those are good things. But at the end of the day, we need to create a better economy so when our veterans come back, there's work for them here. And we need to let them know that there's services for them here too, that they can go get a job, they can be productive members of society, all the while getting whatever help or services they need as well. It doesn't have to be one or the other.
Right. You mentioned leadership. Leadership, fighters, respect. What has being in the military trained you for this position? Both of you. I'd like both of you to answer that.
Well, sometimes it's almost easier to be deployed than to be in politics. But I can tell you that the camaraderie that you develop is extremely important in dealing in any stressful situation. And the same is true in any government leadership position. You need to have good men and women around you who share your values and who are committed to the same ends. And that's essentially what we do in the military. And also, you have to be mission focused and be prepared to take care of your people at all times. That's something that I think stands true to leadership in government or leadership in business or in any site. You need to understand what your goals are, what the organizational goals are, and then you have to take care of the people who make that happen. Mm-hmm. We have a tremendous resource in our people, human capital, in our businesses in New York and in government. And we have to be sure that we reward them, we take care of them, we let them know that our success is based on their hard work. That's something that is ingrained in us.
Right. Well, just as a follow-up, I think, too, you know, part of it is, I know when I was an officer, you know, a lot of it was articulating the mission to your soldiers and explaining to them, this is what we're doing, this is why we're doing it. That's a big part of being an elected office is, you know, going to your constituents and not being afraid to explain, this is what we're doing, this is why we're doing, I agree with you on this, you know, letting you know why decisions are being made or how things are going forward, and also being being comfortable in sometimes chaotic situations. You know, things are going to go wrong. There's going to be things that you're not planning on that are going to happen, but kind of maintaining a certain sense of calm and a sense of focus on what the goal at hand is. And I think people ultimately respect and will follow folks like that, as opposed to somebody who loses their head when things get crazy.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which never happens in all of them, honestly.
Right.
Agreed.
So now being on this side, the government side, you understand what veterans need. Mm-hmm. That's, as we've talked about, jobs, healthcare, as well as education, right?
Absolutely. And thankfully, you know, we were in the military when the federal government passed the new GI Bill, the post 9/11 GI Bill, which certainly makes it education a priority. I know a lot of veterans are attending SUNY and CUNY schools here in New York State, as well as privates, and certainly we want to encourage education, also vocational training, something I didn't touch on, but I think making sure vocational training is available for veterans. Again, there are certain skill sets they have, but they may need to go get a specific skill set if they want to take a certain job. We want to make sure that those vocational trainings are available specifically, if possible, for veterans.
Right. And being in the military really keeps the spirit of America alive, and our freedom really isn't that easy these days.
No, but you know what though? I think it's great for New Yorkers to see folks like Tom and I here. Veterans have that experience we have, and we're continuing. Really, it's a continuation of our service. I'm
Absolutely.
Sure it is for you.
Absolutely.
So what are you hearing from your constituents?
My constituents have been consistent throughout my campaign and throughout my tenure as a supervisor in Islip Township on Long Island. We're not asking for anything except create the opportunities, allow the companies that we work for to survive here on Long Island, to survive in New York State. With so many jobs and so many good companies, manufacturing companies, and others have decided that, you know, it's easier for me to go to South Carolina or Texas. The one thing that if you talk to these business owners, they can't compete with in any of those other states is the workforce. We're New Yorkers. We work harder than anyone in the world. We're committed to our jobs. We spend a lot of time thinking about our jobs. We have that workforce. All we need now is to be competitive with a place like South Carolina or Texas. And we do that by allowing business to grow and develop and not trying to control or hinder that development. And too many times from Albany, there are people who want to pick and choose winners, or they overregulate our businesses and don't allow them to grow and flourish and develop. And we used to do this very well in New York. The Empire State was the Empire State for a reason. We allowed innovation, we allowed creativity, we allowed these businesses to boom. If we do that, it helps almost every sector of society in New York. You're not going to have to worry so much about union issues or who's getting paid what, because there's going to be money there that is not coming from any pot. It's coming from the natural generation of the economic force in our state. We need to allow that to happen. So many of our problems in the state would be mitigated by that.
Less than a minute left. Do you want to wrap it up?
Well, certainly jobs very important. I think in a sort of broad picture sense, just New York needs to look at what other states are doing, and we need to remember that we're competing for other states for jobs. And all too often we put ourselves at a competitive disadvantage. We put our employers at a competitive disadvantage. And we sometimes demonize employers and people who create jobs. We need to change that discussion and start making those people out to be the saviors of the American economy, the New York economy, which they certainly are.
Right. Well, good luck to both of you.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for your service to our country.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator Rob Ortt and Senator Tom Croci. And thank you to all the brave men and women who risk their lives to ensure our voices can be heard. For additional details about the veteran job legislation we discussed, or how you can get help with traumatic memories that's causing emotional and psychological stress on your life, you can access that information online on the senator's websites, ort.nysenate.gov and croci.nysenate.gov.